Welcome. Welcome to this very special event, and a particularly warm welcome to our very special guest, Debbie Tait. Now, typically, I'd kick these things off by giving a brief biography of our special guest. But actually, in David's case, I'm not going to, because I think David's story is best told by David himself. But the one thing I can tell you all, I can promise you all, is that it is a truly remarkable story, which I'm sure will come out both from our conversation and from your questions. We'll leave aside some time at the end for you to ask David some questions. It's also the case that David's story in the not-distant future is going to be told on a much bigger stage, a world stage, and we'll also say some more about that towards the end as well, I think. But just to warm us all up, if that's the right word, which it's probably not, we have got a bit of footage of David on one of his Everest expeditions. So I think at this point I say something like QVT, is that right?
You're lying there, you're trying to sleep, trying to stay warm, because you want to start your summit attempt with all fingers and toes working. You don't want to leave the tent frozen stiff, otherwise you're doomed. And it's a lovely moment. I've made calls from Camp 4 to Vanessa on the sat phone before, and you're just trying to hold it all together. And I've generally found that once I've done my mental checklist and I'm lying there, breathing on a very low rate of oxygen, just having crammed as many Mars bars as I can inside my body, I just sit and wait. And I sometimes say to myself, I'm not going to go to sleep, I'm just going to stay thinking. But invariably, I always fall asleep for that 1 or 2 hours. And then you're woken by this jangling of harnesses as people, headlamps come on. But it's a lovely, exciting moment. Scary moment, I have to say. Because you do know that you're about to put yourself in harm's way. But at the same time, it's a rush. I love it.
David, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Can we start on the Everest expeditions? All of them, all five of them. Mm-hmm. And just give us some sense of what went into those and how you convinced you hold down a high profile job in the city as well. How you managed to combine these two things at the same time?
Well, the whole concept of climbing Everest dawned on me in sitting at my desk in Blue Crest Capital back in 2003. I was sitting there, much like you all are, first thing in the morning, and I looked up on the TV and the Chinese had just got to the summit of Everest, and they were microwaving a live beam from the summit. It was in celebration of Hillary's 50-year anniversary, and there they were, this beautiful crystal blue sky, snow crystals, colorful outfits and everything, and I thought to myself, that's what I'm going to do. And the reason I thought that's what I'm going to do was because over the course of the previous 15, 20 years, in fact longer, I found small vehicles to raise money for the NSPCC for very, very personal reasons. And so I decided in that moment that I'd found my next vehicle. I'd thrown myself out of planes, I'd crashed cars, I'd tried everything, even abseiling down the outside of the Citibank building in Lewisham in 1980-something, front ways to try and raise a bit more money. And now I have my latest vehicle. So off I toddled to Chamonix, learned how to wear crampons, and showed up in 2005 and climbed the mountain the first time. And it was an experience that I will never forget. I was there nearly 10 weeks on that first expedition, which was the longest of all of them. I showed up 13 and a half stone, came back just under 10 stone. It was a very unattractive looking moment when I whipped off my t-shirt for the first time in Kathmandu after 2 months. Shocked to my core, someone so vain. It was an awful moment. But I'd been successful. I'd raised a ridiculous amount of money. I had no idea I was going to do that. I honestly thought I was going to raise £20,000. I raised, I think, £260,000, £270,000. And with that, this whole Everest thing began. Simple as that. That's how it started.
And having done it once, what drove you to do it four more times?
Two things, really. One, like I said, the amount of money I'd raised the first time came as a complete shock to me. And I came back completely galvanized. You'll get to understand what that meant to me on a personal level. And the 6 months after I climbed Everest was probably the only time in my life where I'd felt normal. It was a sense of euphoria that lifted me above a so-called zero line. Imagine a graph. I'd popped my head above the zero line for the first time in a very long time. So that became completely and utterly, I must do this again moment. The second thing was, well, you know, how much money can I raise the next? And so I thought, what can I do next? And so I Googled, had anybody climbed or done a double traverse of Everest, which basically means going up, over, turning round, having a couple of cups of coffee, and going back over. And I Googled that, and no one had done it. I thought, that's it. So I thought, 2007, that's what I'm going to do. So I set out to climb Everest and do a traverse in 2007. The story is a long one, and it's epic, and it's all on Discovery Channel. You can get it for 10p on iTunes, I think, nowadays. And great story, but when I got down the other side, we climbed it, got down the other side, got into advanced base camp, and they all came out banging their cans in celebration. And somebody said, congratulations, you're the first in history to have done a traverse of Everest. I'd not thought to Google, has anybody done it once? It was only in that moment I realized that I didn't have to do it twice. And so in that moment, I suddenly realized, I could smell the Qatar Airways first drink. And with that, we pretended to be ill, got a military flight out of base camp, kidded the Nepalese army that we were terribly sick, and showed up in Kathmandu and went home. I still regret actually not doing the double now, but at that time it was a gold dust to get out of there. And so the legacy continued. I would do it every other year to try and raise money for the charity. I had one momentous failure that you've heard about in 2008, which is a separate story. Mm. And the last reason why it was always Everest was because when I decided to climb K2 in 15, I remember turning around to one lady and I said, I'm going to climb K2. And she went, K what? And then it's then I realized that the only real mountain that is a realistic vehicle to raise significant funds was Everest, because everybody knows it.
And of the five, which was the hardest or the scariest?
Hardest was definitely that traverse. Scariest was towards the end. So two stories. The traverse was, the weather had been bad on the south side and good on the north side, and we were climbing from the north. And so we managed to get to the summit because we managed to get ropes up there, myself and my Sherpa Purba, the two of us together. But nothing had been roped the north side, the south side, sorry. So we ventured off. We stood on the summit, literally, and there's video of us doing it, of my Sherpa turning around to other Sherpas who had got there simultaneously from the same side, saying, where do we go? And that sort of sounds obvious, that when you get to the top of the mountain, it'd be obvious where you go, right? But we couldn't see where to go. And he asks some Sherpa next to him, and it's caught on camera. He's saying in Nepalese, this is the stupidest thing I've ever done. But we spent 17 hours covering 5 hours worth of descent through a blizzard and howling winds and everything, and managed to get down finally in the end. That was the hardest, because it just went on and on and on and on. And you wanted to give up. We were going 10 meters and we'd slump to the ground and lying between each other's legs on the rope. And then we'd force ourselves to our feet another 10 meters, and that went on for 17 hours with no water or anything. It was hard. The scariest was in 2013, when I was charged with carrying a flag from the Queen to the summit. And that was the 60th anniversary, 10 years later. And so I was duty bound to get to the summit first. No pressure then. So I showed up, and we were climbing through what's called the Khumbu Icefall, which is at the base of the mountain, which is the most dangerous place. And three or four of us were climbing together, practicing, essentially. And suddenly I've got Jimi Hendrix in one ear, and suddenly I heard, run, and I knew what it was. And I heard this roar, and I looked up, and there's half the mountains come away, and this avalanche is coming towards us. And I took two ludicrous steps to try and escape it in deep snow. And suddenly it was upon me. I fell on the ground, put my hands over my head, and the avalanche swept over me, twisting me through 90 degrees. And I felt an enormous bang on the top of my head, and it was the first day I ever wore a helmet, luckily, ever. I felt a huge whack on my spine where it cracked something on here, which I felt like I'd broken my leg, and then my arm shoulder came out. When, as I'm lying under the snow, utter terror. Can't describe you. You don't realize you've never been scared until you're properly scared. I remember thinking three things. Wow, your life really does flash in front of your eyes. I thought that was just make-believe. Two, the Queen's going to be really fed up with me because I'm not going to get the flag. I've broken my leg. And three, what a really stupid way to die. That's all in that moment under the snow. With my good hand, I stood up out of the snow. Luckily, it only covered me by a couple of feet. And I stood up and continued. A week later, got to the summit first and got her flag up there, which was the key to success. I cannot describe how many ibuprofen I had in me to get me up there, but I should have been sponsored by them in the following years.
And tell us about, you mentioned there's been failures as well as successes, David. Tell us a bit about those.
One notable one is, and the one I use in my charitable speeches, is a 2008 expedition, which I'll try and tell you in a nutshell. I got to base camp. I got to Kathmandu, set off towards base camp, and I suddenly developed terrible tooth pain. And I couldn't go on. It was absolutely, my face was out here, and I was advised to return to a town called Namshi, where I was told I was fine, the world's highest dental surgery. And I found this dental surgery, and it was a little wooden hut, a rickety wooden chair, a large Nepalese man, and very nervous Nepalese lady holding a tray of rusty utensils in her hands. Her hands were shaking at the time. So as I sat in the chair, the Nepalese man held my ears, and with her knee in the center of my chest, she started to drill into my tooth. But of course, there were no electric drills. She had to use a brace and bit. And so she's grinding, this thing kept slipping from my tooth and made numerous holes in my mouth. And in panic, she then pleaded with me to take a helicopter back to base camp, back to Kathmandu, which I did that night. At the American embassy, the dentist removed the tooth because it was that or go home. And I was sort of fine. I got back up to base camp 3 or 4 days later, and the left-hand side of my face did this. And so I took enormous amounts of ibuprofen and climbed to camp one, where the ibuprofen affected me badly. I suddenly started to literally bleed out, which wasn't very pleasant. I started to descend, went back through the icefall, and I think I fainted, ended up halfway down a crevasse. I was rescued by a Sherpa who took a handful of snow and wiped off all the blood that was around my face. Unfortunately, he wiped off all my factor 40. 3 hours later, when I got down into base camp, my face was like a standout blister. I was shown into the medical tent where I was put in an IV drip, and the IV drip was at sub-zero temperatures. And as that IV drip started to go through me, I started to shake so violently that I was literally bouncing around the tent. But this is the good bit. There were three tall, blonde, Norwegian volunteer nurses working in base camp that year. And all three climbed into my cot and held me until I was warm. And the opportunity cost of those lost 3 hours is going to haunt me until the day I die. I was evacuated the following day. Back to Kathmandu, where I flew home, IV drips and all. My colleague of that year continued to the summit without oxygen, which is no mean feat. But he sits there to this day. I'm afraid he didn't make it down further than 50 meters from the summit. But that was the scariest.
That's pretty scary, right? Wow. So I'd like to come on a little bit to talk about, you do all this for NSPCC. I'd come on a bit as to why NSPCC and why Everest? I mean, what drives you, David, to do these incredible feats, which are very, I mean, absorb not just time, but from what you said, incredibly painful. You know, the drive it must take to complete these things is amazing. So what is it that drives you?
As I've alluded to, since I was a child, and into my teenage, into my adult years, I've supported the charity, and I supported it discreetly, and now clearly more overtly. And that's because when I was a 10-year-old boy, I worked in a shop, and I come from a place where sweets were a luxury. And I got a job in this shop, working with a family member. And one day I stole a bar of chocolate. On impulse, I slipped it into my shorts, and the owner had seen me do that. And I was clubbed to the ground. And all my clothes were ripped off. And as a 10-year-old boy, I was raped. That continued during the course of the summer. I kept going back to that store. I was fearful of people knowing, my father knowing that I was a thief, wielding a cane, that sort of thing. That deterred me against telling anybody. And over the course of that summer, of course of those indeterminate time in my mind now, his friends visited the shop as well. And over the course of that summer, you know, life became pretty intolerable. And then as I drifted into my teenage years, I struggled with all manner of things, culminating in, ironically, joining an industry where the ruthless nature that I'd cultivated as a consequence of that experience actually paid off. I joined Goldman Sachs at a relatively early age. I found that the single-mindedness that had given me, the ability I'd developed to blank stuff out, to be focused, ruthless, for want of better expression, paid off. But as time went by, the legacy of what had happened to me spread like a virus to others. It's best described as collateral damage. People around me, loved ones and not so loved ones, felt the wrath of that. Frankly, not particularly proud of any of that, but as a consequence of it, many people suffered. And it became a huge motivation for me to try and move people's understanding of the problem on, make people become less nervous of it, more understanding, destigmatize it, for want of a better expression. And as I've mentioned in my speech, consider such assaults as common assault, as being punched in a train station, such that people don't hide, don't carry legacies around with them, don't let their lives descend into chaos and perhaps even suicide, and as a consequence, don't affect those around them who mean so much to them. You can't help yourself sometimes. Some of your loved ones are your easiest targets. And so I felt immensely motivated to help the charity, has continued to do so. As I mentioned earlier to Andy, in 2007, I sent, before that traverse climb, I sent out one of my many begging emails, and I mentioned at the bottom, because I was one of those children. And that changed the world for me, because then I had to wear it on my sleeve. I'd chosen to wear it on my sleeve and chosen to try and move the debate along. And that's why trying to find my next Everest, and next Everest, and next Everest, became so important. I'm not a climber, I sat at a desk for my entire career. And through the graciousness of a number of superb bosses I've had, they've afforded me the opportunity to hopefully change the world just that little bit. And I'm immensely grateful to them for letting that happen.
So you mentioned the email you sent around, where at the end you'd mentioned that you were one of the children that had been the subject of this. Was that when you decided to be to open up about that. Was that a conscious choice, David? Had you decided now is the time to speak up about it, or was it sort of inadvertent almost?
I think I reached a point where I realized I was doing an awful lot of damage, or had done a lot of damage to an awful lot of people. I think I realized that there was a degree of mea culpa about it. I needed to get it off my chest. I needed to... I'd done a lot of hiding behind it, to be frank. And in a sense, it was quite cowardly to hide behind it. And I use even the phrase in my speech, hide behind it like a weapon, like a shield, and rather than use it as a weapon. And I just sort of decided that if you could compress time, there were one or two moments in my life where I decided that I wasn't going to do that anymore. And it culminated in that moment, riding on the crest of the wave from the first Everest moment, that now was the time to confess, fess up, and get it out there, and hopefully make a severe impact, because at least in my mind, remember, I was going to climb it twice. And this deserved it. This moment was profound and needed to be used properly, and that's why I did it.
And now the process of opening up has gone beyond an email to you talking about it openly at events like this and many others like them, and also committing those thoughts to words, to paper as well, to a book and to a script. Can you tell us a bit about that process?
Well, back in when I finished that climb, that traverse again, I had two or three months before I started a new role, and I just felt compelled to try and write this thing down for the first time. And I thought I had this I thought I had a clever idea. I thought I'd write 7 or 8 chapters of climbing and 7 or 8 chapters of personal stuff, and I'd weave them like this, such that as you climb the mountain, or I narrated climbing the mountain, you would reach, I'd descend the personal story, such that these two chapters would correspond and it would all make perfect sense. And so I got this, worked feverishly to get this down in a Word document with photographs and everything, handed it to book agents, feeling very pleased with myself, convinced I'd written a masterpiece. And all the book agents thought otherwise. They said to me en masse, could you please get rid of all the climbing? It's really boring. Really, boot, snow, please get rid of the boring. And so they said, but could you write 14 chapters of personal, please, because that's really great. And I didn't have the energy. I honestly didn't. It had taken a bit to get it out of me, and I was moving on, and I was quite grateful I had this big document. A bit disappointed that no one thought I was a genius. But that being said, I moved on. A friend and colleague picked this book up, this manuscript up, and decided, in fact, it was my wife handed it to someone who decided that they were going to use it as a vehicle to make a movie, wanted to enter the movie industry. For roughly nine years, I was a bemused bystander as this script went through various iterations. I sat through hundreds of hours of interviews with writers who, you'd say black, it would come back white, you'd say orange, it would come back green. Somehow it was lost in translation. And it was in a fit of virtual desperation that I offered to write a version of this when we just couldn't seem to get the story right. And luckily, my dispatches from Everest had gained a little bit of a support, so I had a crack at it. And luckily, the script was good enough to be read by Daniel Craig's agent, etc., and it was great. And they said, great page turner, but not a good script. Could you give it to a pro? And it's what we did, who unpicked the rather sugar-coated version that I'd painted of myself, I have to say, all a bit glammy. I didn't realize I did that. It's only when I read it back, I realized, ooh, a bit too glammy. And when she presented her version to me, I was really shocked, I'll be honest, because it laid it bare, and as it should have been. And eventually forced myself to digest this script, And over the course of the last 2.5 to 3 months, we filmed this film. It's been 6 to 7 weeks in London. It's been 2 to 2.5 weeks in Johannesburg, in Pretoria. And we finished shooting on the 21st of May. And this movie is really quite an amazing thing to see. Obviously, from my perspective, it's quite blown my mind. And it hopes to tell this story, or should I say use this story, probably more correctly, to try and do some good. There are three things I'm hoping to achieve from it. One, to educate people what child abuse is, in literal form. I understand if people want to go through their lives not wanting to confront that. I understand that. Don't have to. The second and most important thing is, like I said, to focus on the collateral damage. And that's essentially the unwritten story. There are many people probably living with someone who are suffering through immense amounts of torment and not understanding it, or understanding it and acquiescing to it. Not fighting back, not curtailing that person, because you tend to walk on eggshells around that person, around someone like me, and that's not fair for anyone. And lastly, most importantly, to prove that there is someone out there who will think of you as worthy. And part of the problem, the legacy of what happened to me as a child and happens to others as a child, is you do not believe yourself worthy of, and squirming a bit, you don't believe yourself worthy of love. You don't believe, you're always looking for a plan B. When someone professes to love you, you don't believe it, because you're tainted, and tainted in such a genetic DNA way that you can't quite understand that they do. And so as a consequence, you keep pushing them away, pushing them away, pushing them away. And so what this movie does, in literal terms, proves the fact that Vanessa, my wife, and I call her whack-a-mole, or weeble, that won't go down, has been willing and able to sit through every form of horror that I've inflicted upon her and many other people over the course of our long liaison, and still be there at the end of it and unpick me, for want of a better expression, and haul you away from the edge on one or two occasions, which is and I think that's important for people to see as a thank you to her, but also to others, to realize that those people are out there and don't give up.
And the shooting the film took you back to South Africa, where you grew up as a boy, for the first time in 46 years?
46 years, yeah.
To go back to the house where you grew up, the school you went to. So tell me about, after all that time, how that felt.
Yeah, I never thought I'd actually say, I never thought I'd reach the point where I could say, I've been back to something after 46 years. You never think you're going to say those words. How does 46 years pass? But I got off the airport, I got out the airport after 46 years, never revisited South Africa. Immediately took the cab to my old house, stood outside it, rather bemused taxi driver, watching me fold a little as I stood in front of this peculiar building that is now a fortress. I remember it being open plain, and now it's looks like the Alamo. And then I took a taxi to my old primary school, stood outside that again. Taxi driver starting to worry about me by now, I think, because I'm getting through Kleenex, like you wouldn't believe. And then we took a taxi all the way over to Pretoria, and we began the shoot the following day. And words fail me, really, to describe what it was like to watch this fabulous cast of people play out my childhood in front of my very eyes. The house looked the same. The period, right down to the butter dish in the kitchen, the props were identical, the cars that we used. It was mesmeric, and I got accused of standing there almost zombie-like a lot of the time. Aren't you weird, you just stand there and stare? Well, yeah, I did just stand there and stare and watch this thing play out before my eyes. It was really quite uncanny. And the emotions, I was on this huge roller coaster. I mean, you don't need to go near any substance, you just do this. It was the biggest trip of my entire life. I went from being humiliated in one scene to euphoric in the next, and even the drives from the airport out to the set were, from the hotel, sorry, out to the sets were 45 minutes as the sun came up every morning, were beautiful in their own right. I was mixing with people I never thought I'd ever meet, fabulous actors, and then suddenly there was this 10-year-old boy being asked to act out everything I just described. He didn't know what he was doing, let's be clear, but it was probably the hardest 2 weeks of my life, and makes any, if you condensed all those Everest and K2 climbs into one thing, nothing compared to those 2 weeks. Very, very hard.
You mentioned some of the, so you've got Anna Friel playing your mum.
Yeah.
Is that right? Dougray Scott playing your dad.
Yeah.
This is quite a stellar cast. How did that all happen?
The script seemed to strike a chord with a number of people. Obviously, it struck the wrong sort of chord when I first read it, as I've described. But I think people see the amalgam of all those stories and the timeline once it's condensed, because it's a bit weird for me, because it happened. And to other people, when they tell them the progression of stories and things that happened, they're sort of mesmerized by it. And then the good and the bad that happened during the whole of that journey, I think many actors saw this as, hopefully saw it as a story that was worth telling for the good that it will do, but also had it's a virtually unique tale, according to them. And so I was thrilled when we found that Anna had accepted the part of my mother, Dougray as my father, which was a brave decision because reasons that will become apparent. Mark Stanley from Game of Thrones plays me. Emily Beecham plays Vanessa. And Vanessa and I and my wife, we sit and stare at each other sometimes thinking, how did this happen? Totally weird, you know. And I remember Vanessa turning to me, she said to me one time, she's got red hair. I said, well, look, does it really matter?
Artistic license.
You know, and then we have Alistair Petrie plays my boss from The Night Manager, you may remember him, and it's just been an incredible, incredible ride. And they've all been so gracious as well. They've allowed me to discuss stuff with them. The director, Julian Gerald, who was The Crown, have been amazingly understanding and allowed me to raise a flag here and there when things have not been quite right or not been to my liking. I've hovered in the background and they've tolerated me a lot, looking over the shoulders of the monitors all the time. I don't think I missed a minute of it. Largely because I wanted it to be dead right, as I remembered it. And I wanted it to be even-handed. There was a danger with condensing such a story that you just pluck the bad of one person or the good of one person, and that's not correct. To a large extent, things look normal, but this is the part of the story that this stuff happens in the background of apparently normal families, and that's what I wanted to try and get across in the time that's available in that movie. I didn't want any stereotypical monstrous personas. It wasn't like that, but there were moments of it and contradictions in personalities and shocking lack of consideration in personalities and beauty in other personalities that needed to come out. The first day of shooting, I had no idea the scale of what we'd taken on. There were two white trucks parked outside Exchange House behind Liverpool Street when I showed up that day, and I was so impressed. I mean, I'm standing, two trucks, there's lights and everything. And then there were another 15 articulated lorries around the corner I hadn't seen, I only saw the following day. So I was malleable. But when I first saw Anna Friel standing there as my 50 to 54-year-old mother who visits me at work, and as an example of the things I put people through, I didn't talk to my father, for obvious reasons, for well over a decade, and I chose at the same time not to talk to my mother for 4 to 5 years, for ludicrous reasons, but reasons that were enough to make her very ill. And this was a very long time ago, and I hugely regret this. And one of the ways that she came to see me one day was she faked a name and reception, and I came down to see her in reception, and I was tricked, semi-tricked into it. And Mark Stanley, on the very first day of shooting, and if we'll play this out in front of my eyes. So on the first day, I felt like I'd been hit by a steam train, and there it was in front of me. And that continued for another 60 to 70 days, one after another. Testaments to the good and the bad of this situation, but likely the bad. And I hope people will benefit from having this story told. Very difficult.
So we're coming down. We were discussing the film. It's obviously about your life. But you said to me, I didn't have the chance to ask you then, so I'm going to ask you now. You said, what it really is, Andy, it's a love story. What did you mean by that?
I think when the script first lands on your iPad or in your lap, it's not immediately apparent quite what the story means. You tend to view it as a story about abuse, and I think most people viewed it simply like that. But it became quickly apparent that what we had what none of us had really realized, stupidly really, was that it's a constant tale of betrayal and forgiveness, endlessly. Perceived betrayal and real betrayal by me, and largely constant forgiveness by others, not least my wife Vanessa, and many others, let's be clear, who have tolerated stuff over the course of these many years. And I think there's one line that a doctor, not to give the game away, a doctor in a police cell in one of the scenes uses the phrase, love is a string of endless forgiveness. I think that was the exact words she used. I might have them a little bit wrong. And it was during those, when we heard her say that phrase, that it suddenly dawned on us that this is turning out to be the epitome of a love story, a true love story, real love story. Not Ali McGraw and Ryan O'Neill style love story, but a real one of someone who's willing to, like I said, whack-a-mole. No matter how many times you hit her, she still stands up. And I think if remarkable personality, and I'm sure there are many people out there who have the ability to do that too, but I, for one, wouldn't be sitting in this seat or walking this earth, I don't think, if it hadn't been for that sacrifice and that willingness to take many Mike Tyson-like blows.
I want to turn to the audience, so we've got time for some questions. To David, about there's so much there that we could discuss. But let's start taking some thoughts from you on any of that, from Everest right through to David's very personal story, or indeed the film. He's now a film producer as well. Who'd like to go first and ask David a question about any of that? Should we start? You want to wait for the mic as well? Thank you.
Hi. Thank you very much for your talk so far. It's been really interesting. Do you feel like you were treated differently by the people around you when you told them about what happened in your childhood?
That's a really good question, because I was terrified of that reaction. I remember composing the email on my machine at what was Peloton Partners, when it once existed. 5 o'clock, I hit the send button, but I paused for half an hour with my finger over that button for fear of exactly that. Was my life, were people going to look upon me as a diminished individual, because you're convinced that you are. But I decided to do it anyway, hit the button, and I literally ran from the office. When I came in the following day, nothing had changed. And that's what people need to take away from it. Nothing changes. People are hugely understanding, increasingly more so over the last 10 years since I hit that button. There are one or two people, in all honesty, generally men. In fact, exclusively men, who for that one moment, when they hear that story, when they you tell them that story and you're looking into their eyes, there is a moment where they look at you and wonder whether you were complicit. Until they remember that you were 10, and then it's gone. But there is that moment I've seen in some people's eyes for a second where they wonder, and they run the images through their brain in that microsecond, and then it's gone. But it only lasts a second. There are many people who come up to me after the speeches for the charity and thank me for throwing it out there in front of X people because they feel they couldn't do it themselves. And I always encourage them. I understand why they can't, clearly. But I encourage them to try and do it, even on a much more private basis. The world doesn't end. The world doesn't end.
Do you think, just on that point, David, are we becoming better as a society in talking about issues that, I don't know, 10, 20 years ago would have just been too difficult? It was a stigma, or people found it impossible to give voice to them.
Absolutely, and I think what some will see from the movie is the fact that my mother, I believe, struggled in exactly that vein. Hmm. It came from a certain era where things were unacceptable to be discussed. You wouldn't have accepted them yourself. You certainly wouldn't have confronted issues like that. My father came home and left £30 housekeeping, and my mother did what she did. She made her own clothes and stuff like that. And as a consequence, had no voice, had no strength, had nowhere to go, no money, and as a consequence, accepted things that happened within the family far more than they would say today. We moved on immeasurably. People are far more open. I can only imagine the wrath of Vanessa, for instance, would show others if her children were threatened. But I do think there was an era where things were brushed under the table. Let's not talk about it. Almost Victorian, considered right up to the late 70s, I would have imagined. But I think it's important that the stigma is lifted. People do continue to talk about it. But it's underestimated how difficult it is to do that. Every one of my speeches feels like the very first one. It just does. I always expected it to fade. I mean, I can do the Everest thing story ad infinitum. But when I get to that point, when I have to say those words again, it feels like the very first day. And I come off stage, sit down, and, you know, I'm absolutely drenched from every single time. And so... And interestingly, if I don't mind mentioning the Grant Swanby. Interestingly enough, the guy who plays my nemesis in the movie is a well-known South African actor called Grant Swanby. Terrifically nice guy, very smart. And one day after shooting, we'd tiptoe around each other. He was the actor. This is 46 years ago. And he was an actor playing a part, but we'd stay away from each other. And one day the shooting ended 20 minutes early, and I was leaving the set. And I tried to get a lift back to town, back to Pretoria, and he was sitting in the car, and the dispatcher said, "Oh, jump in that car with Grant." And I turn around, and I bolt. And this is the actor playing my nemesis from 46 years ago, and I hesitated to get in the car with him. And we both stood and stared at each other for a moment. And even he felt comfortable, I felt uncomfortable. So it's like almost absurd. But we got in the car, we forced ourselves to talk. We ended up talking about South African rugby, finally. And 40 minutes later, we parted as great friends. Very decent man, brave man to take on the role. Established character, actor, before you do something like that. But as an example of how it permeates your DNA, but we are improving.
Some more questions. Should we go here at the front?
Sure. I've kind of got three questions. I've got more, but I've limited to three. Good speech, by the way. Or discussion, sorry. So the first one, what planes have you jumped out of? Because they're now doing halo jumps over Everest. and Number two, what do you think about when you're in a tent half up a mountain or Everest, and you've been walking for hours and hours, or climbing for hours and hours? And the third one, is it, does it take more mental strength or physical strength to climb Everest, would you say?
In reverse, I train myself to a standstill, and you take care of the physical stuff, but I've seen very old people, almost infirm people, achieve this, and I've seen Royal Marines show up and go home in 5 minutes. So I have to conclude that it's predominantly mental. I don't believe the mental element is relevant to actually the climbing. That's a physical gym challenge of immense proportions, but it is what it is. The mental stuff is the before. I find I go to bits. I find many people go to bits during that period because you're afflicted with loneliness, boredom, lack of oxygen, the misery of living in a tent with your nostrils freezing closed every night, eyelids freezing closed every night. It gets to you. And you're sitting at home, now you have the luxury of communication. And so whereas I used to be able to escape Vanessa for 2 months, now I can't. Now she's there every day. And that reminder makes it harder to sit there. And essentially onto your middle question was, when I'm higher on the mountain, all I'm thinking about is surviving the next day. It really is a case of watching the clock go and saying to myself, in 12 hours, I'll be at the next camp, or 12 hours, I'll be here. Just keep taking those steps, no matter how painful it'll be, and it is, it's underestimated. You just keep taking that steps, and never, ever, ever, no matter what, come death or glory, am I gonna stop trying? And the first one, I took a skydiving course back in the day. In fact, Vanessa bought that for me as well. I think there's a trend here. So, yeah, I think she's desperate to get rid of me somehow, but she hasn't managed to. And funnily enough, we're going back to, maybe going back to Florida to do more skydiving in November. But, yeah.
I think there was one here and one here. And one over here.
I was wondering how it was coming home after the expeditions and sort of settling back into normal life first after your sort of, you know, big kind of wave of euphoria of climbing Everest the first time, but then also comparative to that sort of on some of the kind of, you know, when you had to go home and you didn't sort of climb the mountain, how did that feel and how did you approach it?
The first one, as I alluded to, was probably the best moment of my life, I think. Or the time when I felt, I think, if you don't mind me sounding presumptive, like you guys feel, like normal. I've spent a lot of time below that zero line, bubbling along, and then suddenly I had this incredible feeling of euphoria, and it was wonderful. For 6 months I felt, and I've described it before, as very much like a self-esteem bucket. You carry this bucket inside you. Most people have a half full to brim full bucket of self-esteem most of the time. Play with the analogy a bit. But someone punctured mine, for want of a better expression, and it constantly empty or draining away. And so what I kept doing was trying to find things to chuck in the bucket to try and fill it up. But in that moment, you know, the Everest finger went in the dike and I've suddenly felt great. But it faded. It faded away slowly, inevitably. And then I think part of the motivation to go back and do the double traverse, etc., was to refill that and also find the next challenge. But inevitably, as with everything, each of those euphoria moments just petered away, such that I don't think I'll do it again, because I think I hit the sell-by date simultaneously on my last 17 climb. I think everybody in my entire email world, I'm on auto-delete now. Everybody just goes straight, even Andy, it's like, delete it, no, every time I send out another ask. So I think everybody are completely done with me, I've got to find another vehicle completely.
Should go here and then we'll come back.
Hi, thank you for coming to talk to us today and for talking out on something so personal. Obviously, you said that whilst filming, it was a constant roller coaster, having to watch someone act out your acts of betrayal and such a personal like experience in your life. Was there ever a moment when you were watching all this that you doubted or questioned the choice to put your story out on such a global and big platform?
Yes. I've been concerned at the fact that because there are within the story so many, I hesitate to overdo it, but bad things, I was worried that they would take the bad elements in the cut and sling them on a screen and hope that it sticks and hope that that in itself sells the story because it's, you know, times salacious, times shocking, blah, blah, blah. And I was worried that someone would take the, be a bit underhand and create this rubbish. But as it became, as it developed, it became obvious to me that the story is what they're trying to create. It, without the themes running through it that I described earlier, it fails fundamentally, absolutely fundamentally, and won't even get made, it won't even get into final print. So slowly over time, I began to trust the crew, began to trust the director, began to trust everybody else that they had, not my interest at heart, but we had the same mandate. We were working to the same mandate, so I relaxed. The other time when I felt that a bit shocked was actually at the very end of the shoot. And not by accident, I think they saved the horrific scenes, frankly, or the depiction of the horrific scenes to the very last moment, the very last day. And I remember standing there, they asked me to leave the set because largely I think they didn't want my reactions or what they thought my reactions would be to affect the young Hugo Stone, who was mesmeric as a 10-year-old me. And it's only, so they pushed me to the corner and I went out to this purpose-built set, which was a shop inside a petrol station. And I watched on the monitor. And I suddenly saw this little boy acting out these, only a camera from the side of the head, that's all it was. He had no idea what he was doing. And I stood watching that thinking, maybe I've made a mistake. Is this too much? Is this going to be voyeuristic to some? Which is a horrible thought that some people might watch it for indulgent reasons, which is an ill, not much considered thought. And I started to worry about that. But I do think that in consultation with the director, the chances of that being shown by more than 2 seconds, you know, which would be enough. I managed to look at the thing as a whole on the plane home and look at all the rushes and everything. And I think that the whole good of it is far more creative and worthwhile than my fears first. But that moment when I saw that little boy, who frankly I'd fallen totally in love with, I have to say, and my wife, Vanessa again, who is a childline counselor, and as I mentioned earlier, much to everybody's amusement, a relate counselor, which is no great surprise when you think about it. She said, "You must be awful watching yourself. You're looking at yourself as a little boy." And I think to a large extent she was right. But you wait till you see him. He's spectacular.
Thank you. We'll go here, I think, and then from the bottom. Thank you. And there.
Thank you very much for sharing this with us. One question with regards to your personality traits. You said that after the incident you became a bit more ruthless and isolated. And I'm very curious how you climbing the Everest gave you the courage to break through and how you took it as an advantage of that personality to climb Mount Everest.
Defining ruthless was during my teenage years, once I realized what had happened to me, once I started to understand it, and I started to question, to be frank, your reason for existing, your sexuality, you question everything. You develop an ability to shut off the outside world. You reach a point where you literally do not care. And as a consequence, everybody around you tends to suffer. You put things into lock-up garages all in your brain. You keep them in there. Now, that's not a good thing, not a good place to be. But when I was focused on achieving a goal, I didn't care about anything else. Everyone, normal people, care about the consequences of trying to go route one. They worry about who they might be hurting along the way. Vanessa says to me, with scarcely veiled antipathy, that I'm the only person who can hand a letter to her once every 2 years saying to be open in the event of my death and get in an Uber to Heathrow and leave the entire family alone. And it's only now I'm realizing that maybe she had a point. And it's that ability to force stuff away, to achieve stuff, that I meant by ruthlessness, an ability to just not care a damn about anything but what I needed to do to achieve. That's where I gleaned an advantage, I think. By extension, climbing the mountain was a case of, there it is, get out of my way, I'm going to do it, no matter what. And it was largely, I think, the first climb was a bit all about me, and by the last, it was most definitive, or in fact the last three or four was definitively about the vehicle and what it was doing. I could well done without falling down crevasses and getting frozen to death. It was really a case of using it for a greater good. But that single-mindedness came from having to exclude everything from your mind. It's the best way I can describe it.
Brilliant. Describe me. We'll go here and then up here, and then we might.
Thank you. Thanks, David, for sharing your story with us. It's incredibly brave and quite inspirational as well to those that might be going through similar issues themselves, no doubt. I'd just like to, I'd be really interested in your views because, you know, obviously through telling your story and the charitable work that you've done, you've obviously had a great impact on society as a result of that work. As a result of the financial crisis within the financial sector, we lost a lot of trust with the public, and you know there was a seems to be a gap there, you know, understandably because of what happened through that period. So I'd be really interested in your views on how you think we could maybe rebuild that trust with the public and maybe make up for some of those issues that happened in that time.
Okay, I think it's a direct link. I mean, I alluded to the generosity of spirit of some of my previous employers. To name Carsten Kingetter at UBS was Mike Platt, to begin with, I think, was the guy who let me go from Bluecrest the very first time and disappear off, numerous occasions, actually. And he just sort of bemused and waved me off and then realized the benefits of what was coming from it. Carsten Kingetter at UBS, Gail de Broussard at Credit Suisse, all amazing individuals who were able to see the, I think, benefits not only to me, I think, they saw it as something that I needed to do, but also the benefits to the wider society, the charity, and those three individuals, in by definition, saw the benefits that were going to come to their own industry, to their own businesses. I think Gail in particular recognized the fact that my exploits spurred others into doing stuff, created a very collegiate feel within the business, had a public exposure that nobody really expected, reading dispatches. It doesn't hurt to say investment banker raises X for X charity. That perception that someone was putting themselves out there all added to a positive image. That being said, I think they did it mainly because they understood me as an individual. They knew what I wanted to do, what I needed to do. I'd set the business in a satisfactory state such that I could go do it. But I do think that it benefited, it turned the entire division that I was running, my perception, into a very much a fund-like world, very introspective. We looked out for each other. It became collegiate. Almost like a hedge fund, you become very looking after each other. And I think that helped. And I think, you know, right the way up in, back in the day, back up to Brady Dugan, they appreciated that change. And I think maybe almost like a domino effect, it knocked on throughout the entire firm. I saw people then do fastnet challenges in yachts, and they'd take sabbaticals, fair enough, but they'd earn them. But they were encouraged to go out and do it. And I think that was a positive legacy of it. I think many institutions can benefit from that. The financial industry, without doubt, can benefit from that. And I also think it helps publicize what is being done already. For instance, I helped with getting Morgan Stanley's Charity of the Year recently and spoke to them last year, I think it was. And the fantastic amount of work that Morgan Stanley does in the background, and every bank does, but we don't get to hear about it. And I think that's a shame. So individuals getting up and going doing crazy stuff. Many people ask, how do you get away with it? How on earth do you get away with running this and doing that? And I said, I just asked. That's it.
That's the result. I'm going to take two last quick questions here and here and here.
Hi, thanks. That's a really good speech. My question is, do you think you can achieve what you have achieved, or do you think you can achieve even more, perhaps less, if you were less ruthless and had more consideration of others?
That's an interesting question, and I think that's very much era-related. I think back in 1984-5 when I joined Goldman Sachs, I think my persona suited that era. That's my perception, my memory of it. Nowadays, absolutely so. We've moved from rules-based to a principle-based culture, which is a great thing. You don't get away with stuff anymore, nor should you. You should be judged accordingly by your peers. There's less bullying, there's less aggression, there's less bad things in our society, and we self-police in that way. So I think nowadays, things are not as acceptable as they were in the past. The legacy of my story really is, if I'd had the help that children get now at 10, 11 years old, none of that would have been necessary. That wouldn't have been allowed to develop. The mistakes wouldn't have occurred. The horrors would not have been inflicted on others because they would have been dealt with at a much earlier state. And I think if anything can come from that, it's the fact that we have that infrastructure in place now. The charity, we have counselors, we have people to ring. Children can pick up a phone. They're educated all before the age of 10 now. Every primary school gets seen. And so legacies like mine shouldn't occur. That's the point.
And last question just here. Can you just pass that along? Thank you.
Thank you for coming to talk to us today. Your stories, the story that you shared today, has shown a lot of determination and tenacity. I know that you mentioned the word ruthless, but I think that's the way in which it came out into the world. And some of the examples you've shown illustrate what you've had to overcome in your personal life and the constant challenges that in terms of your career and even climbing Mount Everest. So what feeds that need in you in terms of challenge and what's next? Because you mentioned that last year was the last time you climbed Everest. So what is the next thing? What is that next thing for you that's going to fill that void that I think over time, as you said before, will fade? So what is the next thing for you?
I have used the film as the most recent Everest. And like I said, it feels like I've done five in one go. I'm thinking about becoming the Bank of England chief economist. But it's not vacant.
It's all yours.
But I honestly don't know right at this moment. It's the filmmaking process has been magical and a window into another world. As I said to Andy, if it were a different story? Would I be so captivated by it? Don't know. The desire to make a difference. I'd like to use everything and try and make a difference. Whether I intend returning to our industry or not remains to be seen. I've now finished this, and the rest is now a process that I'll be a bystander by. So I need to find something. I will find different vehicles to raise money. I don't think it's going to be anything physical because it's sort of done. I don't think I'm going to impress anybody by saying I'm going to do it again. In fact, I think there'd just be a collective groan. So there has to be something. I'm hoping that there'll be a spin-off from this film that means I can raise this. This raises vast amount of money for the charity, and that would be the culmination of it. But to be perfectly honest, right now, I don't know. I honestly don't know. I'm sorry. I wish I had an answer for you.
Thank you.
I'm going for this job.
It's all yours, David. Now, we have a special treat for you all, which I will come to after we've thanked David. Let me just start by thanking you all for coming along in your masses to hear David. 18 months ago, when you came in, dinner over there, Mark Carney and I were there, and you told the story that you've told today, David. And I was so taken and amazed and moved by that to think, you've got to get David back to tell that story to some others across the bank. I think today has demonstrated, I hope to all of you, just what an incredible story that is of adventure and humor and unbelievable bravery and courage. And on behalf of everyone here, please join me in thanking the remarkable David Tait.